Hello, I'm Courtney Davis Curtis, Assistant Vice President for Risk Management and Resilience Planning, and I help lead the University of Chicago's COVID-19 planning and response. We are looking forward to welcoming the university community back to the campus this autumn quarter. Since the start of the pandemic, we have worked closely with UChicago Medicine, the Chicago Department of Public Health, and other experts to implement public health precautions to limit the spread of COVID-19 on our campus. These efforts have been successful, and this year, we have added protection of widespread vaccination against COVID-19 among members of our community. Please visit goforward.uchicago.edu for more information on our plans for this academic year. Today, we will hear from UChicago Medicine's Dr. Emily Landon, hospital epidemiologist and executive medical director for infection control, and Dr. Steven Weber, chief medical officer and vice president for clinical effectiveness. They will share the latest information about COVID-19 vaccinations, the Delta variant, and the collective actions that will contribute to a healthy and successful quarter. Interviewing them is Jeremy Manier, assistant vice president for communications.
Thank you, Courtney, and thank you to Dr. Landon and Dr. Weber for joining us today. Dr. Landon, starting with you, what is new about the Delta variant that we haven't seen before?
Well, the Delta variant is really just a continuation of the variants that we've been seeing in the past. It's more contagious, possibly more dangerous, may cause more severe disease, and definitely causes higher viral loads in everybody that gets it, meaning that you can put out a lot more virus with every breath when you're sick with Delta.
What kind of symptoms should someone expect to see if they have the Delta variant? And are all those different if you're vaccinated?
Some people have mostly the same symptoms, fever, myalgias or muscle aches, fatigue, and cough. But sometimes people don't feel exactly the same, especially like you said, vaccinated individuals can have slightly different symptoms. They might have more congestion, less cough, may not be quite as high of a fever, may not be as sick as they expected to be. Some people have more nausea and vomiting instead. It's hard to say, but oftentimes, if you have loss of taste and smell, you can be pretty sure that you have COVID.
Dr. Weber, how should we think about the threshold for staying home with potential COVID-19 symptoms?
We've had a pretty low threshold for thinking about infection and symptoms related to COVID, even from the beginning of the pandemic. So we still think about things like fever, things like coughing, things like the classic loss of sense of smell or sense of taste. But the bottom line is that in general, we're really trying to stress that if you're feeling unwell, those are times that we want you to stay home. We want you to not be out and interacting with other folks and potentially putting others at risk. So we still want to have that very low threshold for being sensitive about feeling sick, even as we approach what would be a normal cold and flu season.
Do the vaccines that are available protect against the Delta variant? We know that some people who are vaccinated can still get COVID. Why is it still important to get vaccinated?
Yeah, the vaccines were designed and are still quite effective against all variants in preventing the most serious types of COVID infections, those that result in hospitalization, and even those that result in death and other serious illness. So as a consequence of that, when we look at the vaccines, even with the newer variants, where we might still see so-called breakthrough infections of more minor disease, which still leaves you feeling pretty lousy, it's not associated so often with those more complex cases, the kind that we're seeing in the hospital.
So beyond vaccines, do the usual precautions that we've been using, like masking, protect against the Delta variant as well as they have for COVID-19 in the past?
Yeah, so masking is the most effective tool that we have besides vaccines to help prevent against the spread of COVID, especially when everyone's wearing a mask. Masks help hold in your droplets and aerosols, and they are very, very effective in preventing other people from getting sick. A mask for you in terms of protection, if you're around a lot of other unmasked people, is probably going to have only middle of the road efficacy in terms of preventing you from getting COVID if one of those people has COVID. But when everyone is wearing a mask, that really reduces the risk quite considerably.
When people do come back for autumn quarter, a large majority of our campus is going to be vaccinated. What does that tell you about our potential to return safely to in-person activities this autumn quarter?
I think this makes all the difference in the world. And again, you know, as already been talked about a little bit, the vaccine it's not 100% in preventing every case or episode of COVID, and particularly more minor infections, but it's wonderful in terms of preventing more serious complications, including hospitalization, even death. And so as we go into the fall quarter, it's an absolute game changer from where we were this time last year in thinking about how we could conduct the activities, the university, the teaching, the research, and all the great things that happen here. In this case, because of the vaccine, we actually have more latitude to go forward in some of the things that are incredibly valuable to us and to our mission. So the vaccine makes all the difference in the world compared with the past.
So we've found so far that COVID is unlikely to spread in classroom settings. Can you discuss why that is, and how are we working to reduce risks in classrooms and in offices through masks and other means?
Classrooms are pretty controlled settings. Everyone's able to keep a mask on, and everyone's able to sort of be there for a defined period of time, and the interactions are very regular. That means that we can make sure that things that are high risk for COVID, like taking our masks off to eating and drinking, aren't happening in a classroom. We can also make sure that the ventilation is good. At the University of Chicago, we're certain that the ventilation is good enough to handle the size of groups that we're putting in each of these classrooms.
Okay. Do you have any recommendations for students or other members of our community about how to attend social gatherings safely?
We all need to spend time with people outside of wearing a mask in a classroom. And so the most important thing that you can do is keep track of what the community prevalence is or the case counts in the area. First of all, if you're vaccinated, your risk is a lot lower, and you can probably spend a little bit more unmasked time with maybe more people than you spent with last year, as long as the cases aren't increasing. If you're unvaccinated, then you really need to be wearing a mask all the time. You need to stick to the same rules that we had last year.
So what would you say to someone who is vaccinated, but they might have contact outside of work or outside of class with someone who is unvaccinated and maybe vulnerable, such as children under the age of 12?
As long as you can stay masked when you have contact with those people, it's really going to be just fine. But if you need to have ongoing close contact with someone unmasked who may be high risk for a bad outcome of COVID or unable to be vaccinated, and you want to shelter them or protect them, then you need to protect yourself a little bit more too. And that means making sure that you're avoiding crowded situations where people are unmasked. You can't be sure where those people are coming from or what their health status is, so just stay as far away from those people. That's a good time to practice social distancing. The second thing is that you should wear your mask when you're in other settings where you don't know a lot of people, like grocery stores, that sort of thing, where it's not important for you to be unmasked. Avoid eating indoors in restaurants where you might have contact with people that are unmasked that you don't know. That sort of thing can help reduce your risk.
So as we talk about precautions that people are taking on campus, I get the sense that it's really important to have layered precautions, vaccines and masks and other ways of preventing the spread of the virus. How important is that?
So we've been talking about layered protections this whole time because nothing is perfect. And I often hear people argue that we shouldn't wear masks because they're not 100% perfect, or we shouldn't get vaccines because they're not 100% perfect, but that's not the right way to think about it. Instead, we should think of them about like they're adding additional layers. Now, we had a lot of layers last year, a lot of enhanced cleaning, a lot of social distancing, single rooms in dorms, stuff like that. Some of those we don't need anymore because vaccines are such a thick and protective layer. It's like having like two or three different duvets on top of you in terms of protection. They're really helpful. Now, sometimes when cases are high, we're also going to need masks because they're also a really excellent protective layer. It's important to know that the layers that we use are really dependent on what's happening in the community and what's happening inside of your own body. If you're immunocompromised, you should probably talk to your doctor about any additional layers you might need to keep you safe.
Dr. Weber, can you talk about the latest CDC guidance or the guidance from other experts on the need for booster shots for COVID-19?
You know, this is very much an emerging area, and probably after a couple of viewings of a message like this, we may need to update it again. Folks have seen that there's already recommendations out for people with really significant problems with their immune system, maybe as a result of an organ transplantation or different medications that they're taking that reduce the effectiveness of their immune system. And we're already seeing those folks getting vaccinated, not just at our medical center, but across the city and really all over the country. What's out there right now and anticipated sometime between today's date and September 20th is more information and guidance for the rest of the population. We hear and understand that there's going to be recommendations coming from the Food and Drug Administration and the CDC to really give clarity about how we'll prioritize other individuals in terms of booster or third doses of vaccine for those who receive the mRNA vaccines, the Moderna and Pfizer. So there's going to be a lot more information coming out about that. But I think it's worth noting that for many people, and maybe even for most people, this doesn't need to feel like a crisis or a race. We know when the other experts identified those individuals at highest risk, some that I mentioned already. For the rest of us, whether healthcare workers who might have been vaccinated now 9 or 10 months ago, or for older Americans and older people who understand there might be at somewhat higher risk, there'll be some orderly progress in going through that list, but recognize that even where we see there's going to be an advantage at some point for boosters, folks aren't going to need to feel that there's a race to get to the nearest Walgreens or into their doctors on that day to get boosted.
What should we expect to see in Chicago and around the world as the pandemic evolves over the next few months?
I think if this pandemic has taught us anything, it's a little bit of humility about our ability to predict the future. We know and we've seen that as new variants emerge, we might see changes in the epidemiology. What might have been a very quiet period can over a short period of time become much more active. But at the same time too, this active period that we're in at the time that we're recording this today isn't necessarily going to be the way of the future for the next 6 months. And there's really, to my mind and a lot of the colleagues and experts that I work with, not a lot of information say that we're going to reach the kind of peak that we saw last winter. So I think it's really important that we stay consistent in what we do, that as the pandemic ebbs and flows a little bit, we now know the tools that can really help keep things under control and keep those peaks as low as they can and keep those lows as long as they can. And that's vaccination. It's mask wearing. It's being thoughtful about social distancing and not being out when you're sick or feeling unwell. And I think that's the part that I can predict that no matter what the pandemic is doing, those things are going to help in the time ahead.
Great. Well, thanks so much to Dr. Weber and Dr. Landon for joining us today.
Thank you, Dr. Landon and Dr. Weber, for your insights. We will continue to work closely with UChicago Medicine throughout the academic year to provide additional information about the state of the pandemic and the university's precautions. I encourage you to visit goforward.uchicago.edu for the latest information. If you have additional questions about the topics in this video or the university's plans for the autumn quarter, please visit coronavirusinfo.uchicago.edu. Thank you for your continuing efforts to uphold the health and safety of our community.